Okay, this is the second day. I'm showing some code that I've been working on. This is some Java code here. I am testing a class here. This is my testing zone, may we call it like that. So here basically I created this class called Persona. I am actually considering translating my code to English. So more people can actually get involved here. So yeah, whatever, and avoid being confusing in the future regarding my code. So yeah, perhaps I'm going to be moving to full English variable and class naming convention. So at the moment, I created two classes. The first one is called Persona. And what the Persona class does is basically a store. It's going to store basic information about every person that is going to be working here on the inventory system that I'm going to create. So let's see. As you can see here, I'm just creating an instance of the Persona class here, Persona, and this is the reference. It's going to be called Jorge. That's my name, actually. So this is an object, and here is the code to instantiate a new object of the Persona class. And between these parentheses, I am typing the some parameters. I'm using three parameters here: my name, my first name, here my second name, and in the case of Mexico, a third name here. So basically, this is a constructor that is going to be using three different string parameters here, and I'm going to create a person class, a person object here. And all that this program does at the moment is just going to print out the contents of this object here. So let's run this program here, and there we go. I wonder if I can do this bigger. There we go. So as you can see here on line number 4, I'm just typing out this testing area here, just this message, this one here. On line number 7, I am creating a new object of type persona, and it's going to store the basic data, the name of the person here. And here on the line number 8, I'm printing out Jorge. So here you are not seeing it explicitly, yet I created a method, an overwriting method called toString into the Persona class just to be able to type out the full name here directly. So let me show you something here. So this is the Persona class. Let's move to the Persona class here. And here are the main fields. As you can see here, I'm using only a string fields here. They are all private. So let me make this a little bigger. If you are watching this on a phone, I don't know. I may like to help you. Okay, let me see. There we go. So we have a more clear view here. So on the Persona class, I am storing the first name, the second name, and the third name. And this value here is the corp. Here in Mexico, this is pretty much like a social security number for the United States. We do have several security numbers here in Mexico, and this is supposed to be the main one. So that's that. I set some getters and setters with the help of the IDE. So here, I do have some public methods to get and set the values. Even the curp is yet in there, get curp and set curp. Everything is fine. I wonder why this is color gray. Ah, it's never used. Never mind. Okay. So those are the getters and setters. And here, next, we do have the constructors. As you can see here, I do have a no parameter that does nothing constructor here. I do have, and here's where I began what I just talked about in the last video. Here I began building a lot of constructors. I was asking for a name. So in case that the program needs to instantiate a persona just with one name, just with the first name, you should be able to here. And just setting the name to name. That's it. It's a single line here. Here I do have another constructor. This is a little more complex. So here I ask him for the first name, and now I ask him for the second and the third name. So what I'm going to do here is link the first line of the constructor here, line 56. Here I am calling with this line here is going to call the previous constructor, this one. I'm going to be calling this one, and I'm passing as a parameter the name, the first name. So the first name goes here, and this basically sends this parameter here and executes all this. Okay? So basically here I'm linking to a previous constructor. And right after that, I'm setting the second name and the third name right here on this constructor here. And I began doing the same thing over and over. I deleted some constructors because I was getting out of hand with the constructors, basically. So here, it's pretty much the same case with the difference that this is pretty much the same case as the previous one. The only difference is that I'm adding now the curp parameter here. And that's the only difference. So in this constructor on line 72, as you can see, I'm linking again with the this keyword. So I'm calling the this class constructor, and the signature should be this. Three strings, the name, first name, second name, and third name. So basically this line 62, is going to execute this constructor here. This here. So this line is going to call this constructor, and this constructor is going to call this one here. So as you can see here, I am saving a lot of space and code here because I'm just linking constructors with one another. So basically, if I need a more complicated constructor, I can just link to a simple one. So basically, I linked these three constructors here. I did have a lot more constructors because, as I said previously, the constructor building went out of hand. But yet I decided to delete them. So I'm going to be using these constructors here now. Here, when I try to print out the class directly, I get the name. I get some data from the object. Still, when I try to print out the object, I get a hash code at the end. So I may like to have something to work with. So in the plural site, in a plural site .com course called the Java language, I think it's called, I don't remember the name correctly. I learned about how to override the two string method. So this method here already belongs to, I think it's to the object class, which every single class is derived from. So I don't really remember where this comes from, but I'm going to override this method here. So instead of getting some basic data from my object and some hash code, I'm going to decide to print out this. And you can see there is a single line here. I'm just returning the result of this method here. So get nombre completo means get full name. So what does this mean? I'm going to execute this method down here. This is a public method called get nombre completo, get full name. And here I'm applying something else that I learned on the same course, and it's the use of string builder classes. So basically I create here a local variable here, a local object, This reference is called full name, nombre completo. I'm creating a new string builder class from this. And here I'm calling to the append method from the string builder class for the full name. And I appending basically the fields, the name. Yet as I'm working with, as I was doing some testing here, I realized that instead of getting this dot name, this was the first version here. But the thing is that if I don't have a value there, if the name field, there we go, if the name field, it's already confusing, so I should probably rename everything. Okay, never mind. So the name field, if it doesn't contain any data there, if it's empty or null, it's going to create some erratic behavior in the future. So what I decided was to, instead of using the field directly, I'm using this shorthand code for an if statement. So it's going to be fit here. And it's going to be clear. So what I'm doing here on line 76 is basically asking if the name field of this particular object is not null. If that's true, then get the name. If not, then it's going to be equals to an empty string. If I don't do this and I try to print out the value of full name, I'm going to get instead of an empty string, I'm going to get the null keyword. Let me show you something. Let's do this here. So if there is nothing at the name, well, actually it doesn't matter here because even if I don't get anything, no, okay, let's do it. No, just like that. Let's save it. If I run this at this point, I'm going to get, this is my first name. The first two words are my first name. This is the second name, and this is the third name, okay? So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to get back to the main, and instead of initializing, let's just comment out this, copy it, and there we go. So instead of initializing with a name, I'm going to delete the parameters. And the no value constructor is going to allow me to test out this code. So let's do it. And there we go. So as you can see, I'm getting a null value here for the name and empty strings for the rest. So that's pretty much it. So I decided to, here, I returned null, okay? I can actually return null for all this. Okay. So if I run this again, I'm going to get three nulls, one right after the other. And I didn't like how this looks like. Perhaps that was the original, basically. If I don't have a value here, it's going to show null. I wonder if I should actually keep the null. Okay. But at the moment, I basically decided to just leave it like this. There we go. And there is nothing there. I'd rather have this for a command line application here. And as you can see, I repeat the process for the second and the third name here. As you can see here, if this is null, if any of these fields are null, they don't have anything written into them, then I'm going to return a blank string here. And that's pretty much it. And basically, right after I build this string builder here, so I append all this, as you can see here, I just return this as a string. Then The override public to string method is going to just make a call of this, and I'm going to return the result of this. And it's basically, the result of this method here is going to be a string. So all that is just to be able to print out using a system println here directly, okay? So I can, if I decide to print this out, I may get the full name here, okay? So printing out this object prints out the full name. So the second, I think that's it. Okay, this is for the persona class. So I kept going building the persona class, including data that is more related to employees of the organization. So what I decided to do after some time is that this class was getting too much attention from the employee perspective. So I was already considering storing in separate tables the information about people and the information about employees, just to from a database perspective. So I was thinking about let's refactor all the code related to employees into its own class. So I created this employee class here. The employee class here on line number 4, the employee class extends persona. So basically, I'm making use of all the methods and the fields and the constructors on the persona class on this new class here. So that's surprisingly, this class was easier to make because of this, obviously. So the only private field I have here is this one here, RFC. That's Registro Federal de Contribuyentes. That's the name of the Federal Register of Taxpayers, something like that, okay. So I get a getter and setter for this using the IDE. And here are the constructors, an empty constructor, the constructor using the RFC parameter, and I'm calling the setRFC method here from up here. Here, this one here. Nothing fancy here. And here, I do have another constructor that is more complex. If I want to create a new employee, and I want to create the person for that employee, I may send the first name, the second name here, and the third name here. Okay, so what I'm going to do here is in line 29, I'm going to call the super keyword, is going to call the base class, in this case persona, and it's going to match the constructor. I'm calling the constructor matching these three values here, as you can see here. So I'm creating an employee with, and I'm sending to the super constructor, and I need three strings. So basically, first name, second name, and third name, I'm going to be calling this one here. Let me look for the, where are the constructor here. So I'm basically calling this constructor here from the extended class employee. So I'm executing this code from the persona Java file here, from the persona class. I'm calling this constructor, executing all this code. I'm linking this this other constructor up here. And here, at this point, I realized of the real power of object-oriented programming. And that was like an epiphany for me, because basically, I was able to reuse easily code that I already built in the past, and I don't even remember it clearly, no? So I'm basically that I see that as a great advantage, because if I use this and give and build proper documentation for these methods and classes, I may even be able to share this code with someone else using the YAR packaging system, and that other person may use my classes freely without problems. Okay. Oops. What did I do here? Okay, never mind. Did something change? Okay, never mind. Everything seems to be fine. Okay, so basically here, oh, I see. There we go. I fixed the white spaces here, never mind. So basically I'm calling the super constructor when I'm using just the first, the second, and the third name. But here, down here, I do have another constructor. So if I do add the names, the first, the second, and the third name, and besides that, I may like to add the RFC code here, the RFC number here. So what I'm going to do here is link to the previous constructor, to this one here, on the first line of this constructor, and then I'm going to set the RFC, wait a minute, now that I looking at this, I may actually refactor this like this. Instead of calling this directly, I may call the constructor. Can I do that? Call this must be the first statement in the constructor body. Okay, never mind. So I guess this cannot be line number two. So, okay, never mind. So I guess I may only call a single constructor here. Well, that's okay, it's okay, never mind. So I'm setting the RFC here, I'm linking to the previous constructor and so forth. So now I do have more constructors here, because what if I want to add the RFC and the curb, because that's an ID number for persona. It works pretty similar to the RFC. It's just another value for the same person. So what I'm doing here is calling the previous constructor, linking it. So it's going to do all the work here and it's going to delegate some work here and so forth. And I set in the curb. What did I do here? And using set curb, just like that. Since this empleado class is extending from the persona class, I think I can just call the set curve method without problems. Okay, and down here, what do I have? The persona class. Oh, here. What if I already have an instance of the persona class and I want to create a new employee object, a new instance of the employee object using that persona object? So basically, I'm passing a persona object here, and I using that to, you know what? I may actually, well, what I'm doing here, I'm calling the the set name, the second name, the third name on the employee object, okay? But what I'm thinking about here is that instead of that, I may like it to do it like this. What if I create a new a call to one constructor and I just do persona dot, I guess I could say get the name, comma, persona dot get second name and persona dot get third name. So what I did in this line, I'm doing the same thing as these three lines of code. So I'm no longer going to need this. So what line 43 is doing is calling to this constructor here, I believe. It's calling this constructor. What is that? Oops, I got lost. This here. So I'm using the public methods from this persona object here to get the values And I'm creating the employee object using those values. So that's basically what I'm doing here. Here I do have another constructor here for the creating an employee, knowing the RFC, okay. And as you can see here, I'm linking to the previous constructor, and with this single change, I do not need to change anything here. So that's great, I think. So I'm just calling the persona constructor up here. And all this code here, this single line of code is going to build the employee object for me. I am setting the RFC here with a method, so that's okay. And lastly, the last constructor is this one here. It's basically the same one as the same signature as the previous one, with the difference that I'm adding the corp number here. So here I am actually making a call to the previous constructor here to do all the work. So as you can see here, I get into the habit to linking a lot of constructors between themselves. And this simplifies a lot of code, because before knowing how to do this, I will actually copy and paste a lot of code inside these constructors here. And that really looks awful. And it's really hard to maintain and read. But never mind. So here I repeat the process for the overriding of the toString method. And in this case, I am using another string builder instance, and it's going to be called name and RFC. So basically, I'm getting the full name of the person, and I am adding some code to print out the RFC code along with them. So if you, the difference between an employee and a person object is that when I decide to print them out, the employee class is going to print out the RFC number alongside the full name. So what I'm doing here is creating a string builder class, and I'm using the string parameter constructor for this class here. And for that, I'm going to call the super, a super method is based, this keyword means that from the persona class, I need to get the get nombre completo. I wonder if I can delete that, because I don't have another method called the same as this one here. So I guess I can just compile that. There we go. Yeah. I guess that if I overwrite this method, I'm going to need to actually be explicit here. Yeah, I'm just going to leave it as it were, because just to be explicit anyway. And here, this if, I'm basically asking here, is the length, is the get number completo, is this method here, is the full name, is empty, then, and the RFC is null. What I'm doing here? And the RFC is not null. I'm going to append this symbol here. Okay. This semicolon here means that that's the character that I'm using. This is the string that I'm using to separate the RFC number from the full name. And what this is doing here is going to, like what I'm doing here, I am asking if the number is not null, then get the number. If not, then just return an empty string. So basically on line 77, I am asking if the RFC number is empty. If not, then print it out. And I'm building this, okay? So basically, I don't need to worry about to get the full name, because this section here takes care of that. And that's another great advantage of object-oriented programming. So basically, instead of working, building my application as a as a great, a big tower of code, a single tower of code, because even using functions, that's basically a big block of code, and functions basically just make that code more manageable. What I'm doing here, instead of creating a monolithic application, I'm creating little blocks that can actually be, they are like Legos. So they basically are these little blocks that can be used to build something great. So I'm calling the super method here to get the full name. And we begin the stream builder object with that full name. If the length is zero, that means that I don't have a full name. So that's that. So let's, and that's pretty much all both classes explain. I think I took a long time here. So to finish up, I'm going to show you some code here. There we go. So as you can see here, I do have a persona called Jorge here, okay? And another persona called Ceci. I am testing another constructor here, the first one. What else was I testing here? Okay, let's. So I created two objects here. Actually, let me get rid of one of those. Okay. And here I'm testing a for each where I add in the two objects here that I created, and I create a new object here in line this array. People is the array. And here, down here, I do have a for each loop here that is going to help me to print out these people here. So let's try that. And I should have, this is the first person, this is the second person, and here is printing out all the persons using the array. Here is the first person, the second person, and the third person here. So far, so good. And now I do some testing with the employees, class. So here, print out a label here. And here I create new objects here, as you can see here. These objects are from the employee class. So I'm testing this first object to create an employee class using the constructor for the RFC. I'm passing the RFC code here, testing code. Another object here, I'm passing the full name and the RFC code. Here on line 31, I'm using the constructor using person class here. I'm passing a person class called Ceci, and now Cecilia Cortez employee object is going to be built from this person class object. And lastly, Jorge Escobar is going to be built from the person class and the RFC code parameter here. I repeat the process to print out the, to create an array called employees. I add all of those employees to the array, and I use this for each loop here to print them out using the overridden method called toString for the employee class. So let's see that in action. Oh wait, I need to remove this closing comment sign there, and there we go. There we go. So let's make some room for this output here, and there we go. So let's ignore this, all this. Okay, so here, let's start from here, from this line here. So for the Fernando, for the Paco object, let me see. Okay, so here's the employees, okay. So from the Paco object here, I only create this employee object with the RFC, and I'm printing out this. So in the, as you can see here, there is no semicolon and preceding this. That was my intention when I created the toString method. And here, Fernando, this is the full name here for the Fernando object. And here we do have the separator, the semicolon. And here is the RFC code. For the NEPS object, I don't have an RFC code, but I do have a full name. In that case, I don't see the semicolon or an RFC code here. And lastly, when I do have the full name and the separator semicolon here and the RFC code here. So basically all those methods work. And that's pretty much what I've been doing regarding the building of the app. This is a second day here. Today is Sunday. I'm drinking some coffee and smelling some candles here. I may like to relax now. Tomorrow I'm going to get to work. So I've been progressing a little bit. I may like to try out two things now. I may like to try out exception handling for just in case I need to validate some of this data here. I may like to apply some of my skills on error handling, and I may like to review interfaces because I don't really get the interfaces at this point. So I may like to take a second look at that topic. I'm going to rewatch the Pluralsight Java course just to get a hold on the interfaces and how can I actually use them. Because I feel like just the same as linking this, linking constructors between them. I feel like interfaces is going to be a very important tool in my belt. So I really going to focus on that. And that's pretty much the thing here. So in the future, I'm going to be working on designing the database that is going to store all of this. But first, it's my intention to go directly using create an engine to manage the data for the application in Java, because I want to learn Java as fast as I can. And I'm actually trying to learn more and more and practice. So I think that focusing on the database aspect is going to make me feel good. But I already have a domain upon the database area here. So I don't feel like I'm going to improve too much. Let's call it diminishing returns for focusing on the database aspect right now. I'm not going to learn too much here. Yet, if I focus on creating the application, on the other hand, I feel like I'm going to improve way more as a developer. So, okay, thank you for watching. This is the second day of development. I don't have too much to show for, but this is what I've been learning so far. So thank you and good night.